understand that when you give your life to the Lord Jesus Christ and you are born again, the reason why the Lord left you behind, he should have taken you to heaven immediately and you die and go to heaven. But he didn't do that. He left you here for a purpose. So why did he leave you here? He left you here because he wants you to do service unto him. Amen? And so that service is what we are here considering this morning. Very, very important topic, because most of us are so carried away when we are here, we forget the reason why we actually live in this world. So the most important thing I want to understand today is about consecration, submission, and service. These are two important hallmarks of a serious Christian.
When you are called by the Lord, you have to consecrate your life. You have to be committed. You have to be submissive. And you have to serve the Lord. So these are very important. Submission. We hear the word submission. Why submit to your husband is always the thing that we hear every time. But what are we trying to talk about submission? Submission entails total
yieldedness to God and to church leaders. Two things. Yieldedness to God first, and then yieldedness to the church leadership where you worship. Amen? His submission is not, I'm a child of God, I yield to the Lord, but anything the leadership says, you challenge it. Then you have a spiritual problem. You have a serious spiritual problem because you are not submissive. Because you are not even seeing God. It is the submissiveness that we see in you to the leadership of the church. That's how it carries on to the Lord himself. Amen? Amen? So remember that we live in an age where many believers are engrossed with their own selfish ambition. You know, today we are running after making money, education, going to school, doing this and doing that. Yes, those things are legitimate things, but let us not be so engrossed that we forget the fact that we are pilgrims on a journey here in this world on a daily basis. Amen? I tell you something. Once somebody dies and closes his eyes from here, everything that you have achieved here is forgotten. What is important over there is, what did you do with the man Christ Jesus? What service did you render to the Lord? So all this running up and down, making money, doing this, yes, you need to work so that you can be able to keep your family, but don't be carried away. Don't come to a point in your Christian life when all you think about is the next thing to do. But the service of the Lord is, put at the background. When you get a chance, you serve the Lord, PRN. You serve the Lord as needed. When they call for things in the church, you don't present yourself. Then they call for anything, you're not there. If they say choir members, you don't want to join. If they say children church, you don't want to participate. You always have a reason why you don't participate in anything. Let me tell you something. The devil is eating deep into you. Because today is gone. Yesterday is gone. Today is about to go. You're not sure of tomorrow. Praise the Lord. So the time that you have, spend it in the service of the Lord, because you are not sure of tomorrow. Amen? Amen? Let us be careful so that we don't give our best of time acquiring the mundane things of this life and the days take us away on our ways. The enemy is very subtle. He always gives us 10,001 reasons why we cannot serve the Lord. There is always reason why you cannot join this one, so that you can join the ushers, so that you can come and join the janitors to clean the house of God, so that you can come and join. No, there is always time. I don't have time, but you're going to find time to die. You will find time to die, but you don't have time. But you're going to find time to die. Or you're going to find time to go for rapture. Amen? So one of those. Therefore, it's very important that we consider this topic, that it has eternal value. This topic we are considering today is very, very important because it has eternal value. So my question number one is, why is the subject of daily Christian service important? Why is this topic very important? Yes, I want Brother Kenneth. Why is this topic we are considering very important?
You know, in my class, I'm going to call you. You don't have to raise your hand in my class. I'm going to
We have to render service to God because our service has eternal value. We're going to be rewarded and we're going to not be in this world forever.
Very good. Thank you very much. That's an excellent answer. So the topic we are considering today is divided into three portions. The first one is the pattern of Christian service. The second one is the principle of the Christian service. And the third one is the promise to church servants. Amen? So let's look at the pattern. What's the pattern? In Romans chapter 12, verse 1 to 8, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies
a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Brethren, God does not play around with holiness. You see, sometimes I wonder, people say they are Christians, they are fighting, they are keeping malice, they are cursing each other, they are, you know, somebody, offenses will come in life. People, somebody's going to offend you. Yes, you're going to get angry, but you have to, when you get angry, you make it up immediately. You know, you find time again to apologize to each other and move on with your Christian faith. You don't have to stay on it. Stay on it and tell me, I don't talk to this person, I don't talk to the other person, I don't do this. It's wrong. It's wrong. How long are you going to do that? You know, you're going to live a life that is unholy before God. The Bible is talking about presenting your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. You know, many people say, I don't know what the will of God is concerning that issue. I don't know. You know, that's why you don't know. You don't know because you are conformed to this world. If you renew your mind, God is not a man. When God's, the word of God is perfect and the word of God is true. The Lord tells you, renew your mind that you may be able to prove what is good, acceptable, and the perfect will of God. If you renew your mind on the scriptures, you'll be able to prove these things. But if you don't renew your mind, this is like rocket science to you. I don't know the will of God in this. I don't know how to know the will of God in that. I don't know what God wants me to do next. I don't know. No, you can renew your mind and the Lord will open your understanding in Jesus' name. For I say through the grace given to me to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly. The Lord even told us how to think as Christians. How do you think? You say you should think soberly. Don't think, don't see yourself, I am engineer, doctor, barrister, you know, all the things that you have acquired. You know, anytime they call you, it's all about what you've acquired. You look at yourself, you have arrived. I have arrived because you are seeing some change in your pocket. Leave those things. Those things, they have wings, they're going to fly away. Amen? Don't let the devil deceive you with all those things. They are just here. Once you close your eyes, you forget about them. You know, everything is gone. What is important is your service that you rendered unto the Lord. And God is warning us today. Don't think yourself more than you should, but to think soberly according as God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. For as we have many members in one body, and all members have not the same office, so we, being many, are one body in Christ, and every one members one of another, having then gifts different according to the grace that is given to us. Whether prophecy, let us prophesy according to the profession of faith, or ministry, let us wait on our ministry, or he that teacheth on teaching, or he that exhorteth on exhortation, he that giveth, let him do it with simplicity, he that ruleth with diligence, he that showeth mercy with cheerfulness. You see, the Lord is telling us how to live our daily Christian life. You know, whichever gift God has given you, you know, it may be God has given you a gift of teaching. When you stand to teach, everybody gets blessed, and everybody wants you to keep teaching. People say, oh, I thank God for that ministration. It's not from you. What did you have that you did not receive? Amen? The Bible says, what did you have that you did not receive? So if you received it, why are you boasting? It don't mean about that. If God has given you a gift of giving, you give it with simplicity. You give it with cheerfulness. You are happy doing it. You don't have to go about telling everyone, oh, I am the giver. You don't need all that. You see, and don't look down on the other person because he does not have a gift or he does not have the kind of gift you have. God has given everybody something to do, some kind of gift in one way or the other. Just identify your own and use it to the glory of God. And whichever one God has given you, you thank God for that brother, you thank God for that sister, because all of us are working together. We are members of one body. Amen? If there is nobody greater than the other person, that's not why we are Christians. Praise the Lord. So our daily Christian service have four diverse areas, but could be summed up in four sections. The first one is our service to God, which I just read in Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. A second one is from 3 to 8, our service to ourselves. That's where the Lord is advising us, which I just read. The third one is our service to the body of Christ, other believers. You have to serve your brethren. If you are given a job to do for the brethren, do it to the glory of God. You know, do it to the glory of God. That is the only way. You come in here to clean the church. You're not cleaning it for yourself. You're not the only one in the church. But you find time to come in here. You wash the bathroom. You wash the kitchen. You clean this. You clean that. Let me tell you, you are only heaping your blessings for God. Amen? God is going to bless you. And your service to the world. So the one of the most important areas Before I go further, I'm going to ask my second question. Mention the four broad areas in which we may categorize Christian service. Mention two. Latoya, give me two. I mentioned four. So give me two. Yes. And somebody else will give me two. I mentioned four. I said service to that. I mentioned four. So give me just two.
I'm afraid I'm not following.
Okay. Service to God is the
service
first one.
Service to God. Uh-huh.
Okay. And I mentioned, so I want someone that, yes, Sister Jackie, mention two.
Service to God, to self, to the church.
Use the microphone, please. People are in Zoom.
Service to God, to self, to the body of Christ, which is the church, and also to the world.
Okay. So service to God, service to ourselves. Service to the body of Christ, which you have to help other people, what you do for the church, and service to the world. So in all these areas, the most compelling and daily on our daily service is evangelism. Evangelism is something that is we cannot knock it off. Amen? It has to be deliberate. You have to get up from your house and say, I am going out for evangelism. That's why somebody says, I'm born again. I've been born again for 50 years. And you don't have a soul that you can present to the Lord and say, this is my convert. This is someone that the Lord helped me to use to bring to the Lord. I doubt that kind of Christianity. Is very disturbing. Because it simply means you're not growing. You have a child that you gave birth to. You are feeding the child. And 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, that child still remains like a day old. Oh no, something is wrong. He needs some home care. Amen? That child has a problem. That's how you are, a dwarf in the spirit. If you give your life to God and you're not evangelizing. Do you know that evangelism is a deliberate? When you say deliberate, I mean intentional, purposeful. That means there's a motive. You have a motive why you're evangelizing. And you prayerfully put every effort to share the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Why are you doing this? Because you want to save men from hell. Amen? If you really understand that people that you are greeting every day are going to hell. I'm telling you, people are dying like no man's business. People are dying. You turn around, this one just died. Turn around, this one just passed. Turn around, this one just... Do you know, statistics tell us that 8 people die in a second. That's what statistics tell us. 8 people die every second. That's why people that God has opened their eyes to and give them revelation will tell you, oh, I was in the line. Many people joined the line. Because people are coming. People are coming, frequently coming. So yeah, that's your next door neighbor that you say hi every morning. He's going to hell. Oh. He's not born again. He's on his way to hell. So we need to ask God to open our understanding in this area so that we can see the sense of this matter. I'm telling you, because if we don't see the seriousness of the matter, your parents are dead, they're not born again, it doesn't bother you. Your children are dead, they're not born again, it doesn't bother you. Your aunties are dead, they're not born again, it doesn't bother you. These people are going to hell. They are heading to hell. There are no two ways about it. You can bring them to the church and pray the prayer you can pray. Look, if they are not born again, if they did not give their life to Christ, they are going to hell. Amen? So when we evangelize, we are serving God and we are helping others make very important decisions. And we are helping them out of darkness to light. Amen? Amen. So if you say you're a Christian and you don't have anything to evangelize, then there's something wrong with your Christianity. Brethren, God is not mocked. You know, sometimes there are several people that claim to be Christians and they think they can serve God at their own terms. You can't serve the Lord at your own terms. God has a way. It's just like the universities. Universities have their way. They want you to come in and take the SAT and pass your high school. You bring those things together and then they will look at it and give you admission. The same way to heaven. If you do not meet up the criteria for God, you are not going to enter there. You cannot get crashed into the university. Let me tell you, you can enter UNC. Every morning you go to a classroom and sit down. Lecturer may not know who you are. You can do it for 4 years, but you are not going to come out with a degree. Amen? Because you are not a student. No, your name is not in the book. Your name is not in UNC book. Every day you attend. You are there. You know? You don't have a department. I had a boy like that in my university. He was attending classes in UNN. Then one day I met him, I said, brother, he said, I'm not a brother, my name is Friend, call me Friend this. I thought he was a Christian, and I said, what's going on? He said, I don't have a department, I just show up. I couldn't believe my ears. I thought it was a joke. And people told me that that's how he has been for some years. So something is wrong with him. So what I'm saying is, we are helping people to escape from hell. Evangelism, therefore, is every believer's daily service to the Lord. Are you evangelizing? If you're not evangelizing, take it upon yourself. Get up in the morning, have it at the back of your mind that I'm going to talk to 2 people about Christ today. Even if it is in the place of work, Even if it's in Walmart, you can have some tracks. As you're coming out of the store, give it to people. Let Jesus be something that you're conscious of. Unless you begin to see men that people are going to hell. Even if they don't show up in church, it's okay. The Lord knows you're doing the best you can. Make sure that you have a motive, an intention, you know, deliberate effort to bring souls back to the Lord. Amen? Amen? So God has given us all these gifts. And also, in your daily Christian walk with God, which area are you serving in the church? Which area are you serving? There are ushering. Every day the brother is shouting, I need help here. I need help. Nobody is coming up. What about ushering? When you are there at that point in time, don't postpone. Oh, when I do this, maybe next year I will join the choir. Maybe next year I will join the ushers. Maybe next month. Don't postpone. Do it as God has given you breath. You are not sure of tomorrow. You're not even sure of the next minute. So do things for the Lord the most you can. Are you among the people singing? What about the janitorial services, people that are cleaning the church? Which area are you? What about the prayer warriors who stay behind here every Sunday to make prayers, to pray for the church and the members of the church? Can't you join something? Can't you? Where are you doing this? How are you doing the service to the Lord? What about the counselors, people who have sat down to study the word of God, look at commentaries from Scofield, from Thompson Chain Reference Bible, people that are deep in scriptures. You sit down and study with all this deck Bible and all these things, and then you can study this. You can have the word of God in depth inside you. You can be a good counselor. Someone has a problem, you sit down with the person. By the time you begin to open the word of God, it's like you're opening the person's eyes. These are ministries in the church where you can be part of it. Amen? You don't just sit down and wait for the pastor to be pushing you around. Why are you not joining this? It's not a fight. You are serving God, not the pastor. Pastor is also strong for his own life because he has a help of people to go. Amen? What about Bible teachers? You know, you study the word of God and make yourself available. If they appoint you to teach the word of God, you teach it with all your heart. You teach it with everything that is in you. Give the best to the master. Amen? You're not doing this for anybody. You sit down, go to commentaries, study. Look for the thing that will help you to understand the word of God. Because what most of us do, we just read a chapter of the Bible, read 10 chapters, and we think we have done God a favor. Let me tell you, you have not done anybody, you have done yourself a favor. The area you begin to study the word of God with commentaries, go to big Bible references, and begin to sit down and study and make notes to prepare for yourself. Because you will be your understanding to the word of God. Amen? 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 So don't sit there. God has given you a gift. You see to the glory of God. There is something. Every one of us, just like we read in the scripture, the Lord has given us ministry. Let us wait on our ministry. You know, if he gave you teaching, teach. If he gave you exhort. If he gave you gift, do it with simplicity. If he gave it to rule with diligence. If he gave you message, show it with cheerfulness. Anything that any area God has given you, do it with all your heart. Don't sit with your gift. At the end of the day, what will happen to you? You'll be like that servant that held on to the gift. And when the Lord approached him, he said, I know that you are a man that sowed not where he did not reap. Are you serious? And what did the Lord do? He cast him out. You don't want to be that kind of servant. Bring yourself out and find the ministry. We are looking for children teachers. Go there and join them. Teach the children. Pray for the children. And ask the teacher, what materials, how do I prepare? Show me how to do this. God will help you to do it. Amen? There has to be somewhere that you belong. You don't come to church every Sunday and sit down and do nothing. No, you have to have a daily service of God. And that is why we are considering this topic. Because at the end of the day, what you did for God is what matters. Only remember by what you have done. Amen? Praise the Lord. Question number 3. Mention some forms of service we can daily engage in as Christians. Sister Chi? Mention some forms of service we can daily engage in as Christians.
Evangelism. And walking in the church.
Thank you very much. So let's go to the second topic, the principles of Christian servants. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 21. I want somebody to open that scripture and read it. 2 Timothy, we are looking at the principles. Principles simply means the attitude of a Christian servant. The attitude of a Christian servant. 2 Timothy, if you are there, read please. Chapter 2, verse 21. Are we there? I'm going to read if nobody is going to read. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 21. Yes, ma'am. Amen. If any man therefore do what? Purge himself from these. What are those? The question is, what are those? So I will need you to go back to 2 Timothy chapter 2 when you get home and see what God wants you to purge yourself from. If you purge yourself from this, the Bible says, he shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified and meet for the master's use, and prepared unto every good work. There is something God wants you to purge yourself from. So the attitude of a Christian servant is what we are looking at. That servant of God must do what? Be born again. Amen? He has to be born again. He has to purge himself from sin. That servant of God must be born again. That's the first thing. Before you can be a servant of God, you must be born again. And many of us here are born again Christians. Amen? So the second of it is, the servant must live a holy and unblameable life. That means that servant of God must allow self to do what? Die. Let me tell you. This is, we shout holiness, holiness, holiness. Holiness is not tying scarf and removing earring. Holiness is when the self in you have died. When self have died in you, then you can be able to live a holy life. You know, dressing well modestly as a Christian is good, but that's not what holiness is all about. Holiness is all about dying inside you so that a new you will come out. Praise the Lord. And that's something that we have to pray God to help us so that we can die. When the I and you have died, you know, some things will happen, the Lord will give you grace. You know, holiness will help you when you have died inside you as a person. Then there are so many things you will be able to endure. But if you have not died inside you as a person, there are so many things you will not be able to endure. Praise the Lord. And we have to pray that God will help us to come to that point. So we have to serve the Lord with an attitude of sobriety. We read it in Romans chapter 12, remember? Verse 3. We read it there. It says, for I say, through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think what? Soberly. According as God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. The Lord says you should think how? Soberly. Think soberly. That's what God wants us to do. That is the attitude of a Christian servant. The principles of Christian servants is what we are looking at. The fourth one is serve with favor and zeal. Serve the Lord with favor and zeal, not with laziness. Serve him with favor and zeal. Let the zeal of the Lord consume you. Serve God with favor and zeal, not with lukewarmness and grudge. You know, they say we should go for evangelism. You know, today I just have to go so that they will not ask me tomorrow now whether I went for evangelism. Or when they climb the pulpit, they'll be shouting evangelism. I even feel guilty. Let me just try and go out and talk to one person. And they carry the tract and say, here, take, stand in front of Walmart. You take, at least, thank God, at least I've done evangelism before they start condemning somebody. That's not what we are talking about. Serve God with zeal, not with lukewarmness. Serve God with supplications, lots of prayers. You will kneel down to pray. It's not only about you and your family. What about the sisters in the church? The brothers, are you mentioning their names before God and praying for them one by one? Let me tell you, if you pray for your brother and your sisters in the church one by one, God give you grace. Write their names on your back of your book. Be praying for them one by one. It will be difficult for you to be fighting with each other. Amen? Because that prayer you pray for them, God gives you love for them. Praise the Lord. Serve in the power of the Holy Ghost. That's what we are rounding up. So the last one is, I'm not going to ask my question. The promises of Christian servant in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 11 to 15, I'm not going to read. There is a reward for an enduring servant. If you endure, there is reward for you. Amen? There is also a promise of eternal life with the master. In John chapter 12, verse 26, we are not going to read. And you shall be honored by the Lord. What a wonderful thing to be honored by the Lord. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9. I read it real quick. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9. It says, but as it is written, I have not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for them that love him. So you're going to be honored by the Lord. I want us to bow down our heads. It's time for us to pray. Are you really a servant of the Lord? Are you willing and ready to serve the Lord? I want you to pray for yourself. Daily walk with God. Are you walking in holiness and righteousness? If you have any issues with people, settle it. It doesn't take anything. Settle it. Call the person, sit down, talk about it, and apologize even when you are right. settle it. The Lord will help us so that we can make heaven, so we can have a daily walk with him. We can be free in our spirit to serve the Lord. Pray for your brethren. Write their names down. Begin to learn to do that every day you pray. The Lord will help you. The Lord will help us. As we pray for one another, God will surely bring it to pass. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Holy Father in heaven, we thank you for this wonderful opportunity given to us, O Lord, to be in your presence. Father, to study a daily walk with us. Lord, you have advised us so much in the book of Romans chapter 12 from verse 1 to 21, how we should live our life on a daily basis. Almighty God in heaven, Father, we pray that the purpose of this scripture will be fulfilled in every life this day in Jesus' name. Father, we're not going to be hearers of the word. We are going to be doers of the word. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Almighty Father, also give us grace, abundant of his Father, that all our lives will be transformed by your power and we can live daily evangelizing and doing the will of God in Jesus' name. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. Praise the Lord.